Hey everyone, today it's our let's start our third lecture in our discussion on Christianity. And for this lecture, we're going to look at the beginnings and the roots of the Protestant Reformation. We're going to look at a couple of key figures from within that movement, particularly the big man Martin Luther himself. And we'll also talk about how the Catholic Church responded, as well as Western European history responded to the Protestant Reformation. And we'll probably conclude our lecture today in talking a little bit about the Eastern Orthodox Church that sometimes gets forgotten during this period. So let's dive on in. All right, so as always, I like to recap, talk about what we have done so far, where we plan to go, and kind of recapitulate some of the things that we've talked about to help reinforce our discussion on Christianity. So first, as of course, we've talked about how Christianity among these five big world religions that we have talked about and are going to talk about in this class, Christianity is the world's largest religion. And it is a part of those religion that we classify as Abrahamic religions or Western religions, but more specifically as Abrahamic because of the shared history and shared traditions that follow the patriarch Abraham and his children. Also, because of that, that means that Christianity, like Judaism, like Islam, tends to share many of the same traditions as well as same terminology and vocabulary. So, a lot of the times what we're talking about within, whether in Christianity or Judaism, it's going to seem reminiscent. Or that in our discussions, when we progressed from, when we For progress from Judaism to Christianity to Islam, we're consistently building upon each other to some extent, because again, all three of them are Abrahamic religions and they're all responding to each other in their emergences. So thus, this is why it was important to talk about Judaism first, then progress to Christianity, then ultimately to Islam, because in some extent, each of them are responding to each other. While Christianity's roots were and are Jewish, it quickly moved to be a faith that is associated with Europe or with the Greco-Roman culture and lifestyle. So this is why Christianity at times on a theological level differs gravely from that of Judaism. It's ancestral, father. And so as time progresses very quickly, within at least 100 to 250 years, Christianity becomes less and less Jewish and more Greco-Roman. And so in its culture and its context and how it talks about things like God, the role of Jesus, the Holy Spirit, the mystery of the Trinity, they tend to use Greco-Roman terms or Greco-Roman philosophy rather than Jewish philosophies. For the most part of the history that we've discussed, and so far early on with Christianity, much of its early history, all the way up through the Middle Ages, and I would argue still today, it may be not as prevalent, but it's still there in the history of Christianity. Christianity has been and continues to be plagued by Christological issues, meaning who is Christ? How is he God? How is he man? And so there's been some issues still with that. Some Christians embrace it fully, the traditions. Some reject certain elements of them, and they have traditions. But we talked about the church in the East, the Nestorian Christians, that are typically classified as non-Trinitarian, meaning they do not believe in the Trinity. And yet they're still essential parts of Christianity. Because of this issue, again, because of this issue with Christ, In the past, there has been various forms of Christianity's existing, and there are still various forms of Christianity existing today. Many of them are less concerned with with Christ at the center, but still, if you do a close comparison, Christ is still at the issue. We also talked about how, excuse me, we also talked about how things change dramatically, not only for the history of the church, but also for Western history, with the famous conversion of the Emperor Constantine. That we talked about how prior to the Battle of the Mevlian Bridge in Rome, how the Western world was, how the Roman Empire had greatly persecuted Christianity. Christianity was a minority religion that had periodical periods of success, but still had periods of persecution and turmoil. But however, things changed. No longer was Rome considered the Antichrist. No longer was Rome considered the great dragon from the Book of Revelations. With the conversion of Constantine and his patronage of the Catholic Church with a small c at this point, Christianity changed its tune. And now, to be Christian was to be Roman, and to be Roman was to be Christian. And so now we have a new circumstance, we have a new dichotomy, and we talked about that with Saint Augustine and many of his teachings, and now how he argued for the wedding together of the church and the state, and argued for the creation of will eventually become the king versus the pope, or the king and the pope. So for today, however, we're going to be talking about European history after the 1500s. So we're not going to get into the Crusades. We're not going to get into talking about scholasticism within Christianity or the missionary activities, but rather we're going to dive straight into around the 1500s. But so at this time, around 1500, Europe had transformed immensely from where we left it. It had been united by a Roman Empire that was eventually attacked by various Germanic tribes, the Visigoths, the Vandals, the Lombards, all those various tribes of the Germans, if you studied Western Civ. But however, what kept Western Europe together, what kept Central Europe together, was the Catholic Church. This time, Catholic with a big C, the Roman Catholic Church, and that the Bishop of Rome stood inside the power vacuum, embraced his position, and held the church and held Europe together to eventually the crowning achievement of the papacy became the crowning of Charlemagne in 800 and the establishment of the now Holy Roman Empire that had reigned from the 800s all the way up till really it finally met its end in the 1700s. But anyhow, the Roman Catholic Church had greatly united the world, and this is the world that we live in a world where now the Catholic, Roman Catholic Church in Western Europe, Central Europe, is now the biggest thing there is. Specifically, again, in Western Christianity, now that we're talking about, there's also another thing that emerges in this period that will be beneficial, and you will see hides in the weeds and is at the root of particularly Martin Luther's start of the Reformation. And that this whole period, and Martin Luther benefited greatly, and that it would not be for the Renaissance, would not be for many of the humanist philosophers within Western history, if it wasn't for the idea that was blossoming in this period of individualism, that is now a standard practice of modern thought, modern philosophy, and even postmodern philosophy. It is what is an absolute standard, individuality now, and individualism. And so we're going to see that common theme as we progress throughout this lecture today. So now let's talk about precursors to the Reformation, because traditionally, even though I really do like Martin Luther as a figure, as a character, he is quite interesting. Like everybody, he has a lot of baggage, but he is very interesting, and the world would be a different place without Martin Luther. But Martin Luther gets all the cred, even though Martin Luther benefited and stood on the shoulders and on the backs of so many others who came before him. And so traditionally, it's Martin Luther that gets all the praise for the Reformation. Just a couple of years ago, we celebrated as a world, as Western civs, as religious scholars, historians, many Christian traditions, many Protestant traditions, celebrated the anniversary in 2017 of Martin Luther's famous rebellious act and launching the Protestant Reformation as it is now. And so, but however, prior to Martin Luther, as again, there were numerous attempts at reforming the church, and that Martin Luther was kind of the final straw that broke the camel's back, the final crack in the dam. And so he benefited from everyone else. So I wanted to briefly mention a few of these precursors to the Reformation. So first, the real first serious reform movement within Christianity, and it was quite early as the third, the 300s, and more specifically by the time we get to the 400s, was within Christianity known as monasticism, meaning monks, meaning nuns, those people we see in usually brown colored robes with wooden crosses and the weird style haircuts. That's what we're talking about, monasticism. And so when Christianity became legalized within the Roman Empire and then subsequently became a state religion within the Roman Empire, it quickly became abused. Many people became Christians because it was very, people could get rich becoming a Christian. People could gain favor and work themselves up through the government or through the good graces of the imperial court if they became priests, if they became preachers, if they became basically if they became Christians. It literally paid to be a Christian during this time. We talked about very briefly how Constantine made it, he would tax pagans' temple services, he would tax pagan temples over property taxes versus the church. And eventually, several other emperors kind of follow suit and tax the hell out of pagans. So again, it made sense to become a Christian. So expediency was the currency of the day in Christianity rather than personal piety. Many people were becoming Christians for the wrong reasons. So many Greek Christians, particularly Greek Christians in Asia Minor area, so that's modern day Turkey, or those in Egypt, even some in Saudi Arabia, desired to live a completely different life. They saw how wrong, in a way, how fast the urbanization of Christianity was producing corruption, producing greed, and soiling the nature of Christianity. So similarly to what we have already talked about within Hinduism, that the emergence of urbanization and that many people sought to change the dynamics, and thus one way people do it is seek monasticism. The same kind of effort is happening here. Many people sought monasticism, and so they sought, and the Greek word is hermetic, which is where we get the English term hermit from, that people, Greeks, decided to live a complete solitary life, either out in the wilderness, out in the deserts, out up on the mountain, instead of living in the cities because of the corruption, and how Christianity was just becoming diluted with wrong intentions and wrong believers and abuse. The most famous of these Hermetic Christians, these Hermetic monks, were known as the Desert Fathers. And so the Desert Fathers were very popular. In fact, there was many Christians who wrote stories about them. You have read one of these already in your readings on Christian traditions, or if you haven't, you should, about the life of Saint Anthony. Anthony was probably one of the most famous of all the Desert Fathers, but there were so many of them, and there was all these magical stories and mythical stories written about these guys. These guys were rock stars within the Christian church. And eventually, unfortunately, because of these guys' popularity, many people started to flock to the desert to go seek these people out, to go seek these kind of gurus out in the desert in order for them to learn, in order for them to be popular. I would imagine too, if Twitter was a thing, if Instagram was a thing during this time period, people basically were going out to the desert in order to pump up and exaggerate their life on so their social life and posting selfies, posting Instagram photo of these kind of circumstances. People started flocking out to the deserts, and so the traditional way of response for many of these reformers became lost. And so, in turn, a reform movement happened within the reform movement, which is ironic. But two significant people within Christian tradition in the East was Basil of Caesarea. This is and then also in the West, Benedict of Nursia. These were two popular Christian monks, Christian monastics, who in turn decided to write rule books, similarly to what we've talked about within Buddhism, that when we saw early on in Buddhism the corruption within the monasteries of monks taking gold and silver rather than basic needs. And what was the response? All the monks gathered together and say, "We needed a rule book." This is exactly what happened as well. Both Basil and Benedict wrote rule books that became foundational within the Eastern Church and the Western Church. So, if you ever heard Benedictine monks, it's not the same Benedict, but it's another Benedict, and this is what happens. Many of these, in order to have a good reform movement or whatever, it was typical that many Christian monastics would create rule books once they saw that the monastic order was becoming corrupt or the wrong type of people were coming in. So typically they would break off and they would form their own communities and in turn write their own rule books. So that's why in the Catholic Church, you have the Benedictine monks, the Franciscan monks, the Jesuit monks, the cloistered nuns, everything like that. You have these various groups that emerge. However, people still wanted to live the solitary life, and that became kind of the style. But however, especially through Basil's efforts and Benedictine, a movement emerged within the Reformation, or these kind of Reformation movements within the early church, to make monasteries, particularly in the West, and they became symbiotic, and that they became communal orders instead. And so instead of you living out solidarity out by yourself, out in the wilderness, now you live together as a community. And you would all make, solemn oaths together. You would all hold each other accountable. And so similar to what we've kind of talked about with the Sangha in Buddhism, daily meetings, daily worship, holding each other accountable. And so this became the popular style. And so now, pretty much within Christianity, this is the only style of monastic orders within Christianity. But still, there's still some Christians who practice the hermetic lifestyle, but it's very, very rare. Overall, because of these monasteries, many of these monasteries became important sources of knowledge. Many of these monastic orders try to become self-sufficient and not having to rely upon charity, and so that they would produce books, copy books, write books for people in order to make money. And so, because of that, they became sources of knowledge that monks have nothing to do except read and study and pray. So, you typically become book smart during these times. And so the monks typically became producers of books, and particularly the Bibles. And so if it wasn't for the Irish monks in Ireland for several centuries who continued this practice of buying up manuscripts, of producing manuscripts, making copies upon copies of copies, that many of the ancient Greek writings that would later help sponsor and help support the Renaissance and the humanist movement have their roots within the monastic orders in Ireland, who they stopped, they didn't know, or they couldn't read Greek anymore, but they would still translate the text from the original and kept it alive. And so again, these monastic orders were very important. But however, the first real Protestant Reformation and the kind of the first real what we call proto-Protestant reformer was the French-Italian Peter Waldo, who lived in the 12th century. Waldo was a very rich man. Was extremely a rich man. He was very single, very attractive, and had lots and lots of suitors, people who would come to him. And he was the most wealthiest man in northern Italy. Had huge, massive tracts of land, massive king. He owned vineyards. Again, one of the richest men in the world. And the story goes about Waldo. It was that he attended a church service where the minister, the local priest there, was giving a homily. Instead of on the scriptures, he was instead giving a homily on the life of Saint Alexius. And so Saint Alexius is a Greek Christian that died in around the 3rd century. However, Waldo was able to connect with this story about Alexis because Alexis was similar to Waldo, was a very rich man, was one of the richest men in his region in Turkey, and was a young bachelor. All the ladies were after him. But then he abandoned everything once he read Matthew's gospel. About no rich man can enter the kingdom of heaven, and so the story goes for Saint Alexis that he in turn sold all his possessions, diluted himself of all properties, sold them all to the church, and became a monk. And so Waldo felt convicted. He felt that the message of the priest and that the Lord was speaking to him, and so in turn followed Saint Alexis, Alexius, path, his model that he set for him. And so Waldo sold all his money, divested himself of all his wealth, gave his fiance, I think he had a fiance at the time, told her to get lost, basically. I'm going to live out in the country. And he became a radical preacher. And so he was known for his teaching. And part of his teaching, because he was very wealthy, he was able to read the Bible for himself. And he read the Bible and he realized that much of the teachings of the Catholic Church are not found in the Bible, and more specifically, the Catholic doctrine of transubstantiation. And you might, if you're not a Catholic, you might be asking yourself now, what the heck is transubstantiation? Well, transubstantiation is a doctrine within the Catholic Church that it is the belief that once the priest blesses the bread and the wine that is consumed at every Mass during the Eucharist, that once the priest makes the special blessings upon the wine and the bread, that mystically, mysteriously, without real explanation, except it's a miracle, and then once the wafer, the priest gives the wafer or the bread to you and you drink the wine from the cup, that at that instant, God miraculously changes it to the literal blood and body of Christ. And so this is this doctrine of transubstantiation. And so Catholics continue to believe this, pretty whole cloth now. Most Catholics will still believe in this doctrine. However, again, most Protestants, no, they do not believe in this. And this was one of the rallying cries against Catholicism, this doctrine that doesn't really make sense and is not really biblical. He also preached a basic message from Matthew's Gospel, chapter 6, in which Jesus says, "No man can serve two masters. He'll either love one and hate the other." And so, in his idea, this meant about personal possessions. No man can serve possessions, can serve money, can serve society, can serve the rules, and serve Christ at the same time. And so, thus, he's asking everyone else to follow his suit, abandon everything, sell all his possessions, and come and follow Christ. Well, because of this also, Matthew's, because of that Matthew Gospel chapter 6 statement, he also would use that passage to say, God and Christ is saying no man can serve the Pope. He rejected papal authority, rejected things that were not biblically true, because again, no man can serve two masters. He must serve one, which is for Waldo, it is Christ, and is the basic message of the Bible. So, again, he was one of the first reformers, and this would become a pattern. So you can see he's creating patterns here, rejecting the Catholic doctrine of transubstantiation, rejecting papal authority, rejecting non-biblical doctrines, as well as he was one of the first to advocate for the New Testament, the Gospels, to be written in the vernacular language of the people. And so if you might not know what vernacular means, vernacular is a Latin term that we have here in English that basically means common tongue. So here in America, the vernacular within America is English. Hopefully everybody can speak English. If you go, for example, if you go to say certain parts of Louisiana here in America, or if you go up to the province of Quebec in Canada, you will hear French. French being the vernacular that is spoken among those people, because that is the common tongue among these communities. So he was advocating for the New Testament to be written in the vernacular. And the reason he's advocating for that is because traditionally among the church, starting really from the 200s and going forward, the church had always believed that the language that the Bible was written in, so at first being Koine Greek, the Greek of Jesus's time that was used, that the Bible was originally, or the New Testament was originally written in, was also the language of God. And so, therefore, you cannot translate it into another language because it is the language of God. Once the Catholic Church and the Greek Church split, once the East and West split, starting around 450 CE, a new translation of the Bible emerged in the West because the West spoke mostly Latin languages the Bible became translated into Latin by Saint Jerome, and so the Bible during Waldo's time was left untranslated from Latin, and by the 1300s, the 1200s, the only people who spoke Latin were either the wealthy, the upper class within the courts, the kings, pretty much for sure, and the church are the only ones that spoke Latin or could read Latin. Most common people spoke their own vernacular language. So they spoke here, Waldo's Italian, Italian French, so they were speaking old Italian, old French. English were speaking, old English, and then so they weren't speaking Latin. They were speaking another language. And so scholars estimate that probably maybe less than 10%, probably even less than that, actually could read and speak Latin amongst, the population of Western Europe. So you only have less than 10% of the people who could read the Bible. So thus, everyone was dependent upon the priest and his interpretation of what the Bible was. Now, you also have to remember that the Bible wasn't as accessible as it was today. That you can, there was no Walmart that you can go and buy a Bible for $9. There's no, you can't search it on your phone at this time. Bibles or books were very expensive to produce because they're all being handwritten. It takes time to produce a book that was handwritten, and sometimes years it would take to produce a book. So that meant it cost a lot of money. So not everybody could read the Bible. So this was something revolutionary, because now if the common people could hear the Bible for themselves, could understand it for themselves, could read it for themselves, they wouldn't trust, simply have to trust the authority of the Catholic Church or the authority of their local bishop. They could think for themselves. And so you can see here, this is the beginning of individualism. This idea is slowly growing. And so at the root of Protestant Reformation is that basic Renaissance humanistic theology, or not theology, but philosophy that emerges and manifests itself by the time of the Enlightenment, and that being individuality. So eventually, Waldo, by 1170, had a huge, large number of followers, people that did exactly what he did, sold all their possessions, and came and followed him, wandering around the northern Italian countryside, preaching their gospel, occasionally going into France. And so, in histories, sometimes you'll see the phrase, his followers were known as the poor of Lyon, there in France, but typically they're always referred to as the Waldensians, named after Peter Waldo. So eventually, in 1179, a word gets to the Pope, Pope Alexander III, about Waldo and how he was making a mess in northern Italy and southern France, how he was getting large groups of followers. And so the Pope sent an invitation to Waldo. However, Waldo, he took the invitation because he's like, man, I get to go meet the Pope. Of course, I'm going to go to Rome, go to the Vatican City, go to all the museums. Oh, definitely, I'm going. And he actually misunderstood what was going. And subsequently, Waldo actually went to a trial, and he didn't realize he was at a trial meeting the Pope. And so he was put on trial, and he was found guilty of his crimes against the church, and he was condemned, but he was never really punished. He was just simply excommunicated from the church, meaning excommunicated is a fancy word for saying you're kicked out, bud. Hit the road, Jack. Don't come back. And so that's what happened. He was excommunicated. He was forced to live outside of the graces of the people, the graces of the church, kind of labeled as a disturber of the peace. So he didn't have much friends. So eventually, Waldo was able to escape, him and his group, and they fled deep inside the Italian Alps, which at that time there's not many good roads, so it was very hard to traverse. So typically you didn't send an army up to the Alps to go find somebody. If you went to up into the Alps, you're going to hide and hide there forever. And that's what he did. He eventually hid up there, him and his followers. Him and his followers produced the very first ever Protestant proto kind of creed that many subsequent Protestant groups would follow and have similar basic beliefs. And the Waldensians survived as a Protestant group, or this kind of semi proto-Protestant group, for a long period of time until they are eventually absorbed into John Calvin and his group by 1532. So another person that we need to talk about is one of the of a big hero of mine as well, within the Christian traditions and within English history as well, is John Wycliffe. So Wycliffe is a little bit different in that he was an English priest who also taught at the local seminary there at Oxford University. So he's very smart. And he was always, at least as early as I can remember, that we have writings from him, always highly critical of the Catholic Church, specifically in England. And the reason that he was that way is because in England, the Catholic Church happened to be the largest landowner of lands in England. And England during John Wycliffe's time was suffering through a plague. Was suffering through parts of the early Black Death, as well as famine in the land, and also due to the Hundred Years' War that was going on between England and France. So it was a very rough time, and so people were starving to death. People didn't have enough land to grow crops, but yet during Wycliffe's time, the Catholic Church had a lot of land. A lot of land, a lot of, and the priests would grow crops on their land, but that grain, those crops, would not be for the English people. Instead, they would go back to the Vatican, go back to Rome. So, of course, John Wycliffe, who's, so much, he's Mr. Pro-Britain, he's Captain Britain here. He's got, the Union Jack tattooed on his chest, and he's just pissed off as could be because, again, the Catholic Church was not being sensitive to the English people. And there's some other issues that all evolve around early forms of English nationalism, that reasons why he was very critical of the Catholic Church. And also, too, at this time, within the history of the Catholic Church, the Catholic Church actually, there was at one point during Wycliffe's own lifetime here, that there was actually two popes. At one point, the king of France, I can't remember, if, I think it's one of the Louis, but I can't remember which one. There's over 16 of them, so I can't remember which Louis it is. But Louis, one of the Louis, actually bribed the pope. That he bribed the officials and he got the man who he wanted to be pope. And he bribed him by building him an amazing palace, an amazing castle that still stands today in Avignon, France. And so he said, Pope, he basically walked up to the Pope and said, here's the keys. And so, of course, the Pope's like, well, thank you, man. But then he says, but there's strings attached. If you take this land, if you take this castle, you got to do what I say. And so for about a 70-year period, the Catholic Church, the Pope, didn't reside in Rome. Pope actually resided in France. The Vatican was moved to France in Avignon. And so it was known in Catholic history as the Avignon Papacy. And many of these popes that were appointed by the King of France, in order to do, give favors to the King of France, the Catholic Church considered at one point, eventually said, enough's enough. We don't consider these guys, this guy, legitimate. And so we, as the bishops, we're going to elect our own pope who's going to stay in Italy. And so at a time, you had two popes. And even also, at a time, very briefly, in a couple of years, it's actually had three popes, all fighting for themselves. And so John Cl Wycliffe thought, this is just stupid. How ridiculous is this that we have two popes, at one point, three popes? And they would be coming, they would go on tours like politicians, asking for money, asking for people to support their campaign, to support their papacy. And he's like, look at you. He's like, hey, Pope, hey, dude, hey, Catholic Church, look at England. We are suffering from the plague. We are suffering from famine. Our people are starving to death. We have no time for you, and you're asking us for money? How dare you? So, of course, he became very critical of the Catholic Church. But specifically, why we're talking about Wycliffe here in the Protestant Reformation is because, again, he famously advocated for the translation of the Bible into English. But unlike Waldo, Wycliffe actually could do it and actually did do it because he's a priest, he's a seminary professor at Oxford, he had access to manuscripts, he could read Latin very well. And so he decided, well, I'm going to actually make my own translation of the Bible. And he did. In 1832, he produced the very first Bible that was written in another language, that was not Latin in Europe. He produced a translation of the Gospels in English. And then 2 years later, he produced a translation of the New Testament. And so Wycliffe's Bible became the standard, became the kind of standard bearer within England, became quickly adopted in England, and was the Bible up until really right before the King James Bible was eventually produced. So he was very popular, and he was actually working on the Old Testament translation, but subsequently died of a heart attack in 1384. And so Wycliffe argued during his life that the Bible was the only reliable guide to understanding God and to understanding what God desires and to be a Christian. And so thus he maintained that all Christians should rely solely on the Bible rather than the church and the church's teachings and church traditions for their salvation. So he subsequently declared war on the Catholic Church. He was also one of the first reformers to argue that all Christians were predestined to be elected. This will come later in Calvin, so I wanted to bring this up now because Calvin picks up on this. And because of that, all Christians, because they're predestined from their birth, that's what predestined means here, that prior to their birth, they have been chosen by God to be saved. And so in Wycliffe's mind, it's because of that that makes all Christians able to have equal access to God, that we don't need to have a priest, we don't need to have this mediator, this saint-like figure that's in between us and God. God had chosen us from the beginning to be saved. Thus, God is saying, the Bible is saying, we have access to God. And Martin Luther will pick up on this. And of course, Wycliffe rejected all Catholic teachings that were not in the Bible. So things like purgatory, things like celibacy of the priest or the clergy, things like going on pilgrimages, selling of indulgences, praying to the saints and praying to Mary, all those things are not in the Bible, and he rejected them all, as well as rejected transubstantiation. And eventually, because of his teachings, he actually caused a riot in London known as the Peasant Revolt in 381, in which Wycliffe rallied a group of people that raided the church for food, kicked out the priest, and stole their lands, basically, to raise food because everybody was starving. And so, in turn, the Catholic Church called for the head of Wycliffe. But however, Parliament saved Wycliffe's life. The English Parliament, they stood up to the Pope. And what helped too is because the Pope is in France. Well, he's actually now in Italy at this time, back in Italy at this time. And England sits on an island, so it's very hard to get to. So the Pope couldn't do anything about it. But however, The popes and the Catholic Church never forgot Wycliffe. And so that's what I have here, that eventually after he died in 384, but the Catholic Church still held a grudge over him. And so eventually in 1415, they declared him heretical. And then eventually later, Pope Martin V actually ordered Wycliffe's bones to be dug up from his grave and to be burned. That's how much the Catholic Church did not like Wycliffe. But nowadays, Wycliffe is a hero within England. His name is given onto the largest publication society in England that produces the most Bibles in the world. And so Wycliffe is one of the, he's given that honor for one of the top publishing companies of the Bible. So the last precursor that I want to talk to you about is, sometimes he's known as John Huss in certain translations, but his real name is Jan Hus. He's a Czechoslovakian. So he's this Czech theologian who was a preacher, a famous preacher in the Bohemian region of Germany. So it's if you know your German countries, your German history. Bohemia is on the southern part of Germany, closer to Austria and parts of Austria as well. And so parts of even Czechoslovakia are considered part of Bohemia. And so similarly to like Wycliffe and like Waldo, he denounced the papacy. But however, how he became famous is he wrote a famous history book, a history book on the history of the papacy and the clergy, in which he listed all the moral failings of all the papacies, all the popes, and all the clergy that he knew about. And so you're saying, well, what did the popes do that was so bad? Well, I could spend an entire class on that, but here very briefly, there was popes who had all priests are supposed to be celibate. Well, we had popes who actually had sex with prostitutes, and eventually one of them had a child, and subsequently his child became the pope later on. So that's ironic. There was one pope that had molested children that was known about but was covered up way back then. So the Catholic churches had problems with that. Even back in the, he was in the 1200s. You had one pope that declared war on a rival Christian city and actually conquered it, besieged it with armies, and took the people and killed other Christians. You had a pope that was murdered by a fellow, just a common man in Rome, because he caught the Pope sleeping with his wife in bed. And so these are all the stories that Jan Hus talks about, and he kind of asks the questions, why do we follow this man? Why do we have a Pope when the Pope has a history of corruption? And so he gained a lot of popularity. Hus had a very large following that are known in history as the Hussites. And actually, that they at one time had a local government. And he actually got the local government on their side against the Catholic Church. And they actually fought a little civil war between the Catholic Church and local communities in Bohemia that sided with John Hus. But eventually, the Catholic Church ordered the Hungarian king, who is close by, Sigmund. Parts of Hungary are also considered part of Bohemia as a region, to put an end to the riots and to call Hus into questioning. Hus agreed to help the king end all the riots. But however, during this agreement, the Catholic Church actually kidnapped Hus and tried him in secrecy, and they burned him alive at the stake when he refused to recant his teachings. And thus, instead of quelling the riots, it caused a war. And so the people of Bohemia rallied around Hus followers, the Hussites, and they actually started a war with the Catholic Church. And the Hussites actually won the war, forced the Catholic Church to compromise and offer a peace treaty that was known as the Basel Compact in 1436. And the reason that's important is because the Catholic Church recognized the Kingdom of Bohemia was recognized, or the territory of Bohemia was recognized as the first kind of ever Protestant nation. It was a to be a Hussite nation. So we have the beginnings of a Protestant nation. So now let's get to the big character. But before that, I forgot, we need to talk about a couple of things that help set up this narrative of going on, of these four themes that are very common amongst the Reformationists. We're only going to talk about really three reformers, and we're going to talk about another kind of movement, reform movement. We're going to see various different styles of reform movements, but they were all reacting to the same thing or had all the same basic themes. So the first one you could probably guess, as you're seeing, is papal overreach, or the overreach of the Pope in church matters as well as state matters. So at the issue, at the heart of the Reformation was this grand dissatisfaction, this grand sense of anger and resentment towards the Catholic Church, but it was more specifically aimed at the position and the policies and the treatment and the sense of entitlement that came with all the popes. That particularly in the West, because there was no, emperor for such a very long time, really the Pope became an unchecked de facto emperor. He ruled all of Western Europe as an emperor. And so, very briefly, I wanted to show you this clip. It's an example from a popular TV show a couple years ago about what I'm talking about as a pope being this unchecked de facto political leader. Hopefully, it'll start here. There we go.
In 6 months, Italy will hold a general election, and you will try to maintain or increase your 41% share of the electorate. And right now, everything indeed points to your ability to maintain that 41%.
Yeah.
But just imagine, a few weeks before the election, there comes an announcement. Pope Pius XIII has decided to appear in public for the very first time to talk to the Italian Catholics. What morbid curiosity. The whole world is dying of curiosity, and it is absolutely to be expected. It's normal. We all want to see that which is hidden. We all want to stare the forbidden in the face. Pius XIII appears. And so do his beautiful blue eyes and his soft, round mouth. A dazzling image, so dazzling it blinds people. In other words, a powerful and evocative image, not unlike that of Christ. But Pius XIII doesn't merely dazzle. He offers reassurance as well with a magnificent speech full of quotations in Latin. Tells them that they, the faithful, must not be afraid. And why would they be afraid with a pope as handsome and as reassuring as Christ? Last of all, just a few short weeks before the election, the pope says just two words. Non expedit. You know what that means?
No.
No, of course you don't. You're far too young. The Non Expedit was first issued by Pius IX in 1868. It was eliminated by Benedict XV in 1919. But guess what I can do? What I, who am not answerable to 41% of the Italians, but only to God, who, by the way, doesn't express his displeasures on social network if I make a mistake. Guess what I can do? I can restore the non expedit. The Catholics will rush to Google those words. What do they mean? The non expedit means that the Holy Father decrees it is unacceptable for Catholics to vote in the Italian elections. And do you know what the surveys that you commissioned tell us? They tell us that the number of Italians who identify themselves as Catholics are 87.8% of the population. Now, you may say to me they could simply disobey you. True. But while a Catholic might disobey the Pope, they'd never disobey Christ. I'm already the former. But believe me, if I want to, I can have myself accredited as the latter as well. And when I do, you'll lose your election. Here's how it works. Since you get 31% of your vote from the Catholic electorate, you'd wind up with a mere 10%.
I wouldn't be so sure of those numbers if I were you.
But briefly, I just wanted to... That little scene, you know, you might not have all the details, but you got what it was doing. Jude Law there is playing the Pope, and he's talking to the Italian Prime Minister and saying that you're going to do how I want you to do. You're going to pass legislation that I want you to pass because I have power over the populace who got you elected. And so like that little line he says in there, that those who, you know, I don't have to, be respondent to God because or God doesn't tweet. That right there, that little conversation that they had, that's what I wanted to show you about what I mean about the Pope had unchecked power. Because he's right. God's not going to say his displeasure vocally and not on Twitter. And like he said, too, you know, they might disobey me as the Pope, but then I, as the Pope, I can declare myself to be Christ himself. And because of many of the fervency of the Catholic population and their religiosity, they might be inclined to believe that. And so you can see that's just an example of the power and the overreach that the papal seat often did. And so again, in matters for religion, the church also claimed for himself, or the Pope claimed for himself, papal infallibility, meaning that the Pope is not wrong in his interpretation on religion. And papal supremacy in that the Pope is the supreme authority over the Christian religion and over the church. And so typically, the popes often would introduce new doctrine that the church would practice, and many of them towards the end, and closer to the period of Luther, started to create new papal doctrines that had zero or none biblical support in what they were saying. And so this became kind of the last straw among many reformers. Also, we have to talk about the power and the reality of the Renaissance and humanism that was being discovered. The Renaissance really helped rediscover Greco-Roman culture that had been lost. And so one of the big themes within the Renaissance was this simple term in Latin, ad fontes, which means back to the sources, back to Greco-Roman culture. Because again, many of the Renaissance were believing, they were seeing their culture falling down because of the Black Plague, succumbing to economic crisis and ruin, succumbing to the all-powerful Catholic Church. And they were trying to look for new solutions. And when they found and rediscovered Greco-Roman writings, Greco-Roman cultures, either from many of the monasteries that had preserved them, or quite frankly, actually, many Muslims had already translated many of these texts, and that they, due to Italian travels and trade circuits with Muslim countries, that they brought back these Greco-Roman cultural and these texts that had been forgotten for so many years, but were being kept alive by the Muslims. And so in turn, many other Christians or many within Western societies thought, well, things are going bad. We need to get back to the beginning and back to these Greco-Roman cultures and these texts that were amazing, that sparked a renaissance within art and science. And so many of the Greek philosophers, that kind of the theme of humanism and the Renaissance was the kind of triumph or the message, the basic message of the famous Greek philosopher Pythagoras, who said that man is the measure of all things, meaning and promoting individualism. So subsequently, individualism, the Renaissance, humanism, this ad fontes back to the sources, back to the roots of our human existence, back, and then for the Reformation, back to the roots of Christianity, become a cry and theme. Also, literacy. The Reformation, the scientific revolution that was spurred by the Renaissance, benefited greatly from technological advances, and more particularly, the printing press. The printing press started to happen. You know, the first book was printed by Johann Gutenberg, who actually printed the Bible for the first time in 1439. And so you can see by 1530, there were over 10,000 publication shops throughout Europe, and already 10 million books were being made and produced and circulated. So by the time Luther emerges in the 1500s, there are already printing presses. And so his sermons were becoming books that were cheap and easy to distribute, and they were being distributed. So now let's talk about also as well the rise of nationalism. And so we don't ever think about that. We don't think about publishing a Bible in a vernacular language, having the liturgy of the church being done in the vernacular language as creating nationalism. But see, what it does is because again, what it did is in turn created communities, little communities, and gave prominence to these communities that were divided, who had been ruled by a greater kingdom or were a part of a greater empire. But yet you had for the first time Czechs, people who didn't speak German, who didn't speak Italian, but living in these countries ruled by German kings and ruled by Italian kings, saying, well, why are we a part of these people? We have a language, we have a culture that's being identified. So, because of the publication of the Bible, because of the publication of works being done in the vernacular language, it tended to lead towards a rise towards na a national identity. And more specifically, in Germany. Germany was a loose confederation of over 100, yeah, close to 100 principalities. It never became a state until 1840. And so it was all these principalities that were being ruled by local princesses, local dukes and duchesses, local kings. But they all had a common language, and they kind of forgotten about that. And they had, because of Luther creating the Bible in German, he actually set a revolution in motion that would eventually take its place eventually by the 1700s with the Prussian Kingdom, and then eventually the unification of Germany in the 1840s. And then two, localized religions, empowering the localized government, which also helped to influence the power of Rome, the power of the papacy, because of that. So you have the beginning, all these four themes run congruently with many of these reformers. So now let's get into the reformers themselves. Let's talk about good old Martin Luther. So Martin Luther has a fantastic story. I'll try to tell it as quickly as I can. Initially, he was a lawyer that hated being a lawyer, but his father pressured him to become a lawyer because his father was a miner. He owned a mining company in Germany, mining copper, and he wanted his son to be a lawyer to protect, not only his business, but it was a good profession. However, the story goes is that one night when Martin Luther loved alcohol, loved beer, he was drunk one night and he was going home, and he was walking a long ways and walked in the middle of a thunderstorm, a lightning storm. And the story goes, according to Martin Luther's own autobiography, lightning was striking all around him, even hitting the ground beside him, scaring his horse. He's all alone in the darkness, lightning just hitting constantly all around him, and he's scared to death thinking he's going to die. And so he screams out in the middle of the night, "God, if you can help me make it home, if you can help me make it home this night, I will become a monk." And so, of course, Martin Luther makes it home safe, and he honors his pledge. He quickly, the next day, joins a monastery. And he was absolutely miserable at it. He hated being a monk. He was really bad at it. He was so miserable one of his friends actually helped him through it and said, "You know, Luther, you have a great, fantastic mind for knowledge and learning, but you're not really a monk. Why don't you become a professor, a university professor?" And that's what happened. And he actually succeeded at that. He became a professor at the University of Wittenberg. But then eventually he turned into a rebel, and one that we all, you know, typically Western civilization, we all know of Martin Luther. And Martin Luther is one of the most, if not the most, influential Christian thinker of all time. So again, if we have a Mount Rushmore of Christian thinkers, Christian figures, you know, it'd be Jesus Christ, would be Paul of Tarsus. We put up there Augustine of Hippo. Martin Luther would be on the mountain. So eventually, Martin Luther, was a teacher, was a very popular teacher at the university there. But however, a moment happened when he heard about the preaching of this preacher named Johann Tetzel, who was traveling throughout the region, preaching his unique message. And part of his message concerning the policy of the Pope Leo X, in regards rebuilding St. Peter's Basilica. And so we actually have a little clip from a movie concerning the way Johann Tetzel taught.
"Don't unfurl the banners until the fire ignites.
Everything has been prepared, exactly as you instructed.
Good people of Uteberg, have you ever burned your hand in the fire? Even one finger made raw by the flame will torment you throughout the night. Is it not so? Imagine then, your entire body burning. Not for one sleepless night, not for a week, but for all eternity. Are we to be spared the fires of damnation on the judgment day? Tonight, your Pope, the Vicar of Christ, sends you a gift to save you from such fires. A special indulgence granted for the building of St. Peter's Church in Rome, where the bones of the apostles lie moldering, exposed to wind and rain, desecrated by wild animals. Take heed the words of your Holy Father who says, lay a stone for St. Peter's, and you lay the foundation for your own salvation and happiness in heaven. How? With this indulgence. When? Tonight, and only tonight. Seek the Lord while he is near. Here is your raft.
So this is from, you know, a movie about Martin Luther, but this was John Tetzel, and you can see it, why John Tetzel was very popular as a preacher, very dynamic. I don't know if he actually burned his hand, but he did actually tour with, you know, paintings and pictures that would unfurl at certain times. He did do a lot of charismatic things to get people to buy these indulgences. So what was an indulgence? An indulgence was basically a piece of paper that if you bought it, and it was very expensive, but if you bought it, this piece of paper, it stated that the Pope had given a special prayer, a special blessing to you that could say, that would save your soul. And so you could buy your salvation. And so this was a fundraising campaign and technique. The Pope Leo wanted to rebuild St. Peter's Basilica, the way that the St. Peter's Basilica of the Vatican looks today in Rome. That's how that was Pope Leo who ultimately envisioned that and built everything around it. So he was getting money this way. People were paying for pieces of paper that said you're saved if you paid big money. And a lot of people were doing that. And so John Tetzel, we actually have some of his sermons. And one of his sermons, the most popular thing he would say was, one of the most popular kind of bumper sticker sayings that he would speak was, for every coin in the coffer rings, a soul from purgatory, or sometimes he would say a soul from hell, springs. So you can see it rhymes there. So anytime you throw a coin into the coffer, into the offering plate, into the bucket, a soul from heaven or from hell would go to heaven, would be saved. And so people would pay big money for, well, I can make sure my grandmother is saved and my great-grandmother is saved and my dad is saved and my uncle is saved. You know, you can keep paying so you can see. And then also my child, like in that screen there, you can see the woman is thinking about her and her child being saved. She's wanting to do the right thing as a good mom to save her kid's soul. So you can see this greatly pissed off Martin Luther. Very much so. So in response, what does Martin Luther do? He nails his most famous 95 theses, which is basically 95 statements, on the door of the Church of Wittenberg. So basically what he really did was basically put a front page ad, maybe did a Facebook message and actually, you know, linked the Pope, the person he's writing this against, and John Tetzel, writing this stuff to him. So basically what he did is saying, this is war now. And so his 95 thesis was basically saying, I disagree with you, and this is how I disagree with you on every single level. And so he has 95 sentences, and you've read some of those excerpts, so you can see how Martin Luther is advocating, what he's advocating for, how the teachings of John Tetzel and people like him are not Christian. And at this time, Martin Luther thought the Pope was just being misguided, being misinformed, and he was trying to make him aware of it. But eventually, the truth came out that it was the Pope who was behind all these things. So basically Martin Luther said, oh, hell no. And so what he did was he publicly wrote a lot of materials, a lot of pamphlets that got distributed. He held public forums and public debates where he would debate local priests and other seminary professors. And Martin Luther would just wipe the floor with him because he was a lawyer. And so most famously, eventually in 1521, the Pope, Martin Luther was actually called to go before the Holy Roman Emperor Charles, who was the king of Germany, basically. But he was the king of Germany, Austria, Italy, Spain, and some other territories as well. I can't remember all of them. The Netherlands, yeah, at the time. So he was the Holy Roman Emperor. And Martin Luther has to go before the emperor and defend himself, or he will be killed. And this is where Martin Luther out-lawyered everybody and said, I would recant. I would be willing to recant everything I've done if you can prove to me where I am wrong in any of my writings, any of my arguments with the Bible. If you can do it, then I would happily recant publicly in front of you. But then he famously said, until you do, I stand right here and I wait on you to do it. And he famously said, here I stand, I can do no more. And the emperor could not disprove them. None of the Catholic priests could disprove any of Luther's arguments from the Bible. And so Luther was able to walk away. He out-lawyered everybody. And so eventually he went into hiding, and subsequently, he won the debate and won Protestant Reformation. But ultimately, Luther's lasting legacy within Christianity, but specifically within Protestant, is known as the three solas. And so every Protestant faith, from Lutheranism all the way to, really even Jehovah's Witness, down to Mormonism, Pentecostals, Baptists, Methodists, to some extent, even, Presbyterians, just you name all the Protestant groups, they all believe the same thing, that have this basic core group that Martin Luther preached, the three solas. So what are the three solas? The sola is Latin for only, because again, everybody writes in Latin at this time. So the first one is sola scriptura, or scriptura, which means by scripture alone. And according to Luther's teachings and Luther's writings, Luther believed that that the Bible teaches and that it is true that scripture and scripture alone must govern the lives of the Christian. The lives of his daily life, as well as church practices, how we conduct ourselves, everything must be governed by the scriptures and scriptures alone. You cannot rely on church traditions. You cannot rely on papal authority, on canon law, only the scriptures. And he also went to go far to say that only scripture can interpret scripture, meaning that the popes, the priests, no one can interpret scripture on half of you. You need to get into the Bible. You need to study it. And so also part of scripture alone, Martin Luther introduced the concept of the doctrine of the priesthood of the believer. And so the doctrine of the priesthood of the believer basically said, similarly to sola scriptura, that, and similar to what John Wycliffe said, that every Christian, once they're saved, they have been empowered by the Holy Spirit to become their own priest. They are their own priest, thus able, through the power of the Holy Spirit, able to interpret the scriptures for themselves, able to pray to God for themselves. They have direct access to God. And so basically, what the doctrine of the priesthood of the believer is, this is individuality. You have the inherent rights, natural rights within you. He would add that that's because of salvation, but he's making this argument, the same argument that our founding fathers were arguing here in America over natural freedoms, that you have these unalienable rights as a believer, and no one can take them away from you. And so what Martin Luther was advocating for was individuality. The second sola, sola fide, Latin phrase for by faith alone. So at the time, and still to this day, the Catholic Church has this basic doctrine, this basic ideology that the Church argues that how someone is saved, they are saved by faith in God and through good works. that if you believe in God and if you do good works, you are justified. You become justified by God. God has, in a way, God has to justify you based off this simple dynamics. And they would quote James chapter 2 that kind of says that. And Martin Luther argued against that. Rather, he said, no, it is faith, and because of your faith, God justifies you, and it's because of your justification and your faith are you able to do good works. You can't do good works. You can't buy something like a indulgence in order to be saved. Martin Luther says that's not how it works. So he's arguing against the selling of indulgences. He also argued that salvation was not given by people as the sanctification, purification of receipt of sins by simply doing good works, but rather, again, it's justification by faith alone. And so this is where the Protestant doctrine of justification comes into play, which is now the bedrock of all Protestant beliefs. And the last sola, this one that doesn't get talked about a lot, everybody talks about sola scriptura, sola fide. No one talks about his third sola, sola gratia, which is by faith, by grace alone. And so Luther argued that salvation comes by God's grace. And, Muslims actually believe this kind of thing as well. They might say mercy, but they're kind of talking about the same thing. It is grace. It is unmerited favor from God. Nothing that you did. You could not do any good work on yourself. It is grace. It is faith. And salvation is to be seen as a gift and a gift of love. And he kind of helped reintroduce that idea within the Christian church, a God of love. Because previously, what most Catholics tended to believe is that God, and how they responded to him, is God is this just and king-like judge. And so they treated him like they were fiefs or servants to God, and that you need to prove your loyalty to God. You need to do things to prove your loyalty to the local king. You need to constantly appease the local king in order to receive favor. And Luther blows that idea out of the water and say, no, it's a relationship. And this is what Protestants always talk about, my relationship with God, my relationship with Jesus. It all comes and stems from Martin Luther and his idea of grace alone. And so it was Luther's ideas. He wanted to overemphasize the role of God in the act of salvation, while the Catholic Church wanted to emphasize their role. And so the Catholic Church tends to hold, and sort of still does today, that it's salvation through the church, not through grace alone. So eventually, Martin Luther wins out. The Protestant Reformation wins out, because by 1530, many of the German princesses publicly defied the emperor and the Pope by declaring their provinces, their areas, to believe in Lutheranism. And so thus creating the Lutheran Church, and so for a lot of people, creating the Protestant Reformation. So now let's talk about, so Luther was kind of the face of the movement. Let's talk about the man behind the scenes, or kind of the theologian of the group, being John Calvin. So John Calvin's very important because most of the Protestant forms of Christianity here in America trace their roots back to John Calvin. So that's why we have to talk about him, or I want to talk about him. So while Luther was more of the rebel, more of the reformer, Calvin was the theologian of the movement. He was the brains. He was quiet. He wrote a lot of stuff. Luther wrote actually more than Calvin, but Calvin wrote more substantial pieces of work. So Calvin is most famous for his two things that he did. One is his most famous book known as The Institutes of the Christian Religion, which really became the first apologetic book, which means a defense of. In Greek, apology is not saying I'm sorry, but rather a defense of. So he's giving kind of a defense book, or more like a theological book on Protestant. And so the institutes are actually still studied by a lot of seminary students and preachers when they go to seminary. They still read Calvin's work as being a foundational text for for Protestantism. And also why he's very important is because of his work at the Switzerland city of Geneva, in which he kind of created the first modern-day republican state, or he really created a theocratic state where God, everyone was forced to be Christian, but everyone was to live under Christian principles. But really, in truth, he was he was important for creating the first republican state in the modern sense of the word. But for Calvin, why we were going to bring him up very quickly is he left two lasting marks on Protestantism. So the first, which is the dominant form here in America, is known as the Protestant work ethic or Protestant ethics. So for Calvin, Calvin recognized that the Christian life was much more than just this simple battle, as Martin Luther made it out to be. You know, this battle between salvation and damnation, that you have to fight for the salvation of your soul. Rather, Calvin realized that the Christian life is all about living your life and working, being a productive citizen for a society, for a kingdom. He would constantly use Jesus' parables on the good servants, or on the servants that received the 10 talents. He would use that parable as well, saying Christ constantly talked about living your life responsibly and being a good citizen. And so he came up with the idea that he said for every Christian, they need to see their life, every aspect of their life, particularly their job, as a holy task, that every person has been called by God to do a specific task. So, you know, that this runs prevalent within Protestant theology, the idea that God has placed you at your job. So if you're working a part-time job at, you know, somewhere on the beach, you know, somewhere at Pier Park, that God has called you at that moment to do this task, and you are to treat it as a holy task. So if you're a cashier, you be the best damn cashier ever there ever was, because your work is to be a symbol, a light of God's salvation, of God's you are God's ambassador at your work. And so a lot of Protestant Christians are supposed to have this mindset. Mind you, not everybody does this, but they're supposed to have this mindset, and it comes from Calvin. They're supposed to see their task as a holy endeavor, as a worship service towards God. And so typically this is known as the Protestant work ethic, and it was really foundational in Western society because it helped push the Industrial Revolution, and it really helped sanctify the principle of capitalism and free market capitalism. Number two is probably, you know, more important, and probably where we'll spend a little bit more time on, is his idea that is known as TULIP, or sometimes you'll hear it referred as five-point Calvinism, or sometimes just Calvinism. So every Protestant church, minus the Lutheran church, minus the Episcopal church, falls within one of these points within Calvinism. So Baptists, Presbyterians specifically, Methodists fall into this at some points, Mormons, Jehovah's Witness, Church of Christ, Seventh-day Adventists, everybody falls within this line of thinking. So that's why we have to bring it up. So it forms the heart of American forms of Protestantism and what Protestants tend to believe here in America. So we use the acronym of TULIP to understand his teaching. So the T, the first one being total depravity. And what Luther, or what Calvin means by that, is that similarly to what Augustine taught, every person is completely enslaved to sin from birth, that they are not capable of choosing God, that they have no good work within themselves, that again, salvation is totally an act of grace and mercy. Calvin, instead of Luther believed in sola gratia, Calvin believed in sola medina, or mercia, which, you know, means by mercy alone, that he believed. and salvation that way. And so he believed, again, from the fall, from the famous story of Adam and Eve at the Garden of Eden, that since then humanity has been ever in a fast decline and can never save itself. It needs a saving figure. It needs this sacrificial atonement that would come from Christ's sacrifice on the cross, according to the Gospels. So we are totally depraved as human beings. We cannot save ourselves. There is nothing inherently good about us. The only thing good about us is if God enters our life, and that is it. They typically believe in unconditional election, that God chooses who will be saved and will be saved by mercy alone. Again, no good works. Calvin was adamant about you. There's nothing you can do. You can't buy indulgences. You can't be baptized. You can't donate money to the church. You can't do anything. You can't grow up in the church. Everything is through God and God alone. L, limited atonement. That Calvin taught that Christ's atonement, that Christ's death on the cross was only intended for a few, not everybody. Christ didn't die for everybody, because not everybody will be saved. There will be people who reject them, and according to Calvin's tradition, he said, you didn't really reject Christ. You just were never intended to be saved. Because again, you have no choice in this. If you had choice, then it cheapens Christ's sacrifice in Calvin's mind. Irresistible grace, God's saving grace, cannot be resisted. So you cannot choose. If you are saved, God saved you. You had no choice in it. And P is probably every single Christian, Protestant Christian probably believes this, except Pentecostals. Pentecostals don't believe this. Perseverance of the saints. And so here, it's not so much an idea about forgiveness, but it's more about... if you're really saved, you're not going to sin, because God will keep you. And so if you start sinning, the reality is, well, you are never saved. You were never saved. If you have doubts about your salvation, if you have doubts, if you believe God is real, according to Calvin, you're not really saved. That's a sign. So again, not every form of Protestant believes this, that you might be a 2-point Calvinist, you might be a 3-point Calvinist. Some people are all 5-point Calvinists. Some people are a little bit different. They'll believe, some Protestants believe in what is known as Arminius, who was the counterpoint to Calvin, but we won't have time to talk about them. But you kind of do need to know Tulip, because again, most of every Protestant believes in one of these things, if not all of these things. So typically, most everybody is either 2-point total depravity, unconditional election, or they'll believe in total depravity, unconditional election, and irresistible grace. Nowadays, most Christians have a problem with limited atonement, because the idea is, well, if not everybody's is going to be saved, what about that person out in the woods that never hears the gospel story? Is God that cruel? And meaning, will God send that person to hell if he was born without ever having a chance to hear about the good news? Can you fault him? Calvin would say yes. You know, and so some Christians now have issues with that, and so they don't align themselves with that. But then there's other problems that come with it. So that's John Calvin. So the next of the reformers that we need to talk about is Ulrich Zwingli, or sometimes you see his name as Huldrych, depending on how you pronounce it, because he's Swedish. But Zwingli. So Zwingli, if you had Luther as the reformer slash rebel in a way, and you had Calvin as the reformed thinker, Zwingli was the soldier. He actually took up arms against the Catholic Church. So he was actually a fighter. And he was actually a contemporary with Luther. He actually met Luther at one point. But he was a contemporary of Luther. He was around the same time as Luther. He led the Reformation movement in Switzerland, particularly the city of Zurich. And so the story goes that around 1522, shortly after Luther made his famous speech, Zwingli started to publicly preach a similar message of that of the Reformers, preaching sermons as other Reformers against the Catholic Church. But he added something a little bit different. He added that the use of idols, that the Catholic Church is condemned because of its use of idols, imagery, the crucifix, making the sign of the cross, that those were all signs of idols and that they needed to be purged. So Zwingli introduced something new that will be subsequently taken up later on, and why most Protestants, you know, they don't do the sign of the cross. They don't typically have, crucifixions or images of the Virgin Mary or statues inside the church. But eventually, in 1525, he created his own liturgy that was to be used in his church and subsequent churches around him to replace the traditional Catholic Mass that became accepted by a lot of churches in Switzerland. As I say, Zwingli and Luther both met at one point in Marburg in Germany, but both of them could not agree on how to organize the movement because both of them were very arrogant men, and they couldn't agree on compromises and how to coordinate the Reformation. Zwingli wanted to take up the sword. Luther did not want to take up the sword, so they kind of, they left. You know, they didn't form a boy band, and they broke up. But anyhow, Zwingli's main contribution, why we talk about him, is that he introduced a new doctrine on the Eucharist, or the Lord's Supper, or communion, as most Protestants call it, and that he advocated that we need to demystify the practice and remove it of all its mystical elements and just make it simply a symbolism. That all it is an allegorical practice that we do, and that he actually advocated, instead of doing it every week as Catholics do it or as Episcopalians and Lutherans do it, that he actually advocated that it may be done four times a year, maybe once a year, that we do the Eucharist. Now, because he felt like that Christians were putting too much emphasis on the Eucharist, and so most Protestants followed Zwingli's lead. But however, as I say, Zwingli was a lot more of a radical and actually organized an army and led an army of Protestants against Catholics. But eventually he died in battle. He died very young in 1531 at the Battle of Zurich there in Switzerland. So another group of reformers that were also equally as radical as Zwingli are known as the Anabaptists. And so the Anabaptists don't later become the Baptists. It's just a coincidence in name. The Anabaptists get their name from the two Greek words. Anna in Greek means again, or do over again. And baptism from the Greek word baptizo, which means immersion, so to rebaptize again. And so they actively believe that that a true believer in Christ, they needed to make a public confession of faith, and that they needed to have a believer's baptism. Typically, most Christians were baptized as a youth or as a child, and they were arguing that no, you need to be baptized as an adult, and it needs to be a public confession in the public square. So typically many of these Anabaptists would go and baptize people in the city fountains or in the rivers that ran in between the city, in very public places. They would do baptisms because that's how Jesus did it, in a public place, and made a public profession. And so if you're a true Christian, you need to make a public profession. Also, the Anabaptists were radically committed to Matthew's Gospel, chapter 6, 24, where, again, like Waldo, you cannot serve two masters. So they were the first to advocate for the separation of church and state, that religion and the secular needed to be completely separate. The government shouldn't shouldn't have a say in church matters, and the church shouldn't have a say in state matters. The common practice that is supposed to be here in America, and sometimes it is followed, but every now and then it doesn't. But this is where America gets their ideas from, the Anabaptists. And so they insisted on free worship services, and they were often sometimes characterized as being very charismatic in their worship services. So they tended to draw a lot of controversy. A lot of people didn't like them. And besides baptism, Anabaptists believed that only, you know, adult believers who are baptized as adults, only they can take communion, not anybody. So if you hadn't been baptized and you were in one of their churches, they would refuse to serve you communion. You had to be baptized again as an adult. So that caused more problems and more persecution with Christians. They are also very pacifist. They did not believe, unlike Zwingli, they did not believe in taking up the sword and fighting. So because of that, typically both Catholics and other Protestants actually persecuted the Anabaptists. They saw them as being too radical. So typically they were persecuted and eventually were killed out by other Protestant and Catholic believers. And so at one point, most famously in 1535, over 50,000 Anabaptists were massacred in England and Germany. And so here's a drawing that has survived of a public massacre of a Anabaptist, Felix Manitz, in the public square. So I'm not sure where he's at, but this is actually a drawing from 1538, of his execution in the city square. So that was the Anabaptists. So lastly, I want to talk about one last group within our conversation here, and I want to talk about the Reformation in England, because in England it was completely different, and why we need to talk about it. So the English Reformation represented something completely different than we see in Germany and we see in Switzerland, because the Reformation in England was initiated by the state and not a reformer. There was no Martin Luther, there was no John Calvin, there was no Ulrich Zwingli. It was the state who decided we want to do the Reformation. Now, I would argue against that and say it was really, you can point to people in Scotland like John Knox that helped started the Reformation in England, but typically it is the state that created it. So the story goes that originally the English monarchs were very much Catholic, very much considered the champions of the faith, often persecutors of Protestants as heretics. And in fact, the same Pope Leo that pissed off Martin Luther called Henry VIII at one point, because of his persecution of Protestants, as, quote, the defender of the faith. So both Pope Leo, Pope Henry, not Pope Henry, but King Henry, were buddy buddies. They went on fishing trips together, all that kind of jazz. But eventually a problem arose in England. Henry VIII was the son of, you know, Henry VII, who was, who took over the throne after the War of the Roses in British history, which was about a 70-year period where the throne in England was being fought over because there was no longer clear lines of succession, because children were dying, or kings not having children, and so the line of succession was being very problematic. And so Henry's father took over the country, and so Henry was very adamant about, I know my English history, I don't want to repeat the problems of the past. So he needed a male heir from his wife, and he and his wife Catherine of Aragon was unable to produce a male heir, only produce girls, and later only produce stillborn children. And so he wished to have a divorce because he needed to marry a new wife. However, the Pope at the time, a new Pope, Pope Clement VII, he was actually a Spanish Pope and was very friendly to the Spanish monarchy. So Catherine of Aragon is Aragon's in Spain. the Spanish king leaned heavily on Pope Clement and said, do not allow his request, because then the throne would pass to Spain. And so the Pope said, nope. And Henry said, well, hell no, I'm not going to take your advice. So what am I going to do? I'm going to start my own church. And so in turn, in 1534, after being called the defender of the faith by the Catholic Church, he created his own church. He nationalized the English church, making him the head of the Church of England, and made the Archbishop of Canterbury a kind of de facto leader of the Anglican Church. So as you can see here, the coronation of Queen Elizabeth, that she's surrounded by bishops, and she holds she holds her scepter of power, but also a sacred orb that shows her role as sovereign, but also head of the church. And she's also, not only is she crowned as queen, but she's also ordained in the coronation process as a priest. So you can see, again, the monarch in England is the head of the Church of England. So initially, when Henry created the Anglican Church was very much Catholic, and it's still very Catholic today, but it's more Protestant than the Catholic Church, but it prides itself in being the middle way. So that's how it sees itself all the time. It's a middle way between Protestantism and Catholicism. So it's very Catholic, except that it has no Pope. It doesn't venerate Mary. But it has a monarch, it has archbishops, but it sides a lot with Protestantism and considers itself a Protestant tradition. But eventually, Henry finally had a son, Edward the Sixth, and Edward, unfortunately, was not a very healthy child. He took over as a teenager, and I think he reigned for 7 years or 9 years and died in his mid-20s, maybe late-20s. But however, he was very important because he actually tried to reform the English church to make it more and more Protestant. He actually created and commissioned the creation of the Common Book of Prayer, which is one of the most sacred books within the Anglican or Episcopal Church here in America. The most common book that everyone uses outside the Bible. And he also ordered Bibles to be translated into English, and he was very popular, very beloved, but however, he died very young. So he couldn't finish the completion of the church, the Anglican church, to be more Protestant. So the throne passed to his older sister, who was the daughter of Catherine of Aragon up here. Queen Mary the First, or she is also known as Bloody Mary, because she attempted to reverse Protestant gains within England, and she ruled with an iron fist, killing a lot of Protestants, imprisoning a lot of Protestants. She was very much Catholic and tried to reverse all the stuff that her brother Edward did. And so she reigned for about 8 years, was very unpopular, no one liked her. But she died childless, and the throne was able to pass to her younger sister, Elizabeth, through another mother. I think she was the child of, who was she the child of? Anne Boleyn. Sorry, I just spaced there for a minute. But yeah, Anne Boleyn. So the crown passed to her, Elizabeth the First. And so Elizabeth favored Protestantism heavy, and tried to make arrangements for the Anglican Church to be more Protestant, but also she tried to appease the Catholics too. So she was really the queen, the monarch that created Anglicanism as this middle way, that it was going to be a little bit Catholic and a little bit Protestant, but not too much on either sides. But however, for some Protestants in England, this wasn't enough. And so those Protestants in England became known as separatists in the separatist movement, because they wanted to separate from the Church of England. However, the separatist movement failed to make inroads in England because the monarchy was strong. However, the separatists came to America as the Pilgrims in 1620. So this is where the American Christian tradition comes from these separatist movements within England. So now I want to talk about the aftermath of the Reformation, the end of it, and what was some of the leftovers. So from 1522 all the way up until 1697, nearly all of Europe was succumbed to a ton of religious wars fought between Catholics and Protestants in every single country, probably except Spain and Portugal and Italy too. But in France, there was Germany, in the Netherlands, and Central Europe, in Hungary, and in Czechoslovakia. There was all these wars in Scandinavia, Denmark, all these wars forever between Protestants and Catholics. And it's estimated that over 11 million people died because of these fightings between Catholics and Protestants, and that over 41 wars or conflicts had occur. And so you saw during this time the devolution of the Holy Roman Empire that broke up because of Catholic states and Protestant states couldn't agree to each other, and so the Holy Roman Empire broke up. You saw the beginnings of Germany starting to happen, the Italian states starting to happen, as well as the English Civil Wars, where England killed a king because the king tried to move the country back towards Catholicism. And so in response, you have the English Civil War, you have Oliver Cromwell taking over, and you had subsequently all British kings from here on out are to be Protestants. The British king can never be Catholic ever again. And you also had the beginnings of the conflicts in Ireland between Protestants and Catholics because of the English Civil War as well. So again, a lot of aftermath has happened due to the Reformation. However, the apex of the conflict was the famous Peace of Westphalia, there in modern-day Luxembourg today, the country of Luxembourg, and in 1648, which established the universal practice for several centuries until the Enlightenment came around, of cuius regio hueus religio, the Latin phrase meaning his realm, his religion. So whoever was the king, whatever his religion was going to be the dominant faith of that region. So really what it equaled to, what Westphalia did, was it said to have political unity, you had to have religious unity. And to have religious unity, you have to have political unity. So if you were Catholic, if your king was Catholic, it was best for your entire country to be Catholic. If your king was Protestant, it was best for your entire country to be Protestant. And so we see that examples in European history. So in the UK, you see various laws being passed, known in British history as the Popery Laws or the Papal Laws, in which it imposed several civil disabilities and legal penalties on just simply being a Catholic in England, but ultimately that was reversed during the 1800s. And in France as well, the famous Edict of Fontainebleau in 1685 made it illegal in the country to be a Protestant. And so apparently, according to, I think it was Louis the 14th at this time, maybe the 13th, he is said to have personally killed and exiled 500,000 Protestants during that time. So it was just a terrible period for European history because of the Reformation. However, there was one positive that would come later in the United States by men like William Penn, who founded the colony of Pennsylvania, and Pennsylvania is named after him, as well as Roger Williams, who founded the colony of Rhode Island, and eventually founded Brown University here in America and the city of Providence, that both these men founded their colonies in order to prove that religious diversity actually equals political unity, and political unity equals religious diversity. So they start the U.S. project, the American project of freedom of religion. So both William Penn and Roger Williams are very foundational because they wanted to disprove what the Peace of Westphalia said is the true of the day. And they said, no, it is not. In turn, what did the Catholic Church do? So the Catholic Church had their own counter-reformation. That coalesced around what is known in Catholicism as the Council of Trent, which the Catholic Church met for several years to rethink how they did church, how they were to do Catholics. So basically, I won't bore you, but what they decided, instead of reform, instead of listening to Martin Luther, listening to Calvin, listening to Zwingli, listening to all the wars that were going on and saying, well, maybe the Protestants have a point. Rather, the Catholic Church instead doubled down on everything, everything that they were being criticized. The Pope has too much power. The Council of Trent said, well, we're going to give the Pope more power. Zwingli was saying, oh, you use too much images in the church. The Council of Trent said, well, we're going to double the amount of images in the church. They basically doubled down on everything. And this became the position of the Catholic Church all the way up until 1868 with Vatican I. And there were slowly some changes that ultimately Vatican II in the 1960s dramatically changed the Catholic Church and reversed a lot of the positions that the Council of Trent had held. But also during this time, during the Counter-Reformation was known as the Inquisition within the Catholic Church, where a lot of Jews, a lot of Muslims in Spain, a lot of women who were declared as witches were being slaughtered and killed as a way to codify the region into believing one faith in Catholicism. So the last thing I want to talk about, I know we kind of run long, but the last thing I want to talk about, because it's, I try to, when we talk about Christianity, I want to bring up the East, the forgotten East, as I say here. So again, for most part of church history, when we get to the Reformation, we tend to stay in Europe, or we tend to jump to America when talking about Christian church, Christianity, and we tend to forget the East. But Christianity existed in the East forever, can still exist today in the East through the Orthodox Church or the Church of the Orient. So here we're going to talk about the Orthodox Church. So sometimes I'll say the Church of the East or the Eastern Church or the Orthodox Church. I'm talking about the Orthodox Church. But that can be defined very largely. It can be Greek Orthodox, Serbian Orthodox, Romanian Orthodox, Ukrainian Orthodox, Armenian Orthodox, Russian Orthodox, Bulgarian Orthodox. The list goes on because the Orthodox Church ran their system a little bit differently. But the Orthodox Church survived and largely survived and benefited from a close alliance to the Byzantine Empire. The old Roman Empire still survived, and so the Orthodox Church survived with it. And so why we have so many Orthodox Church is because the Greek Church, or here, the Orthodox Church, believed heavily in a college of bishops that ruled over all the churches versus a singularity. The Orthodox Church embraces plurality. So when the Greek Church started to evangelize to the Slavs in Europe and to the Serbs of the Balkan regions, they actually encouraged these new Christians to not adopt Greek practices, but to create their own practices, to nationalize the church, to nationalize their Bibles, to have the Bibles written in their own languages, to develop their own liturgy in their own languages. So the Eastern Orthodox Church never had the Protestant Reformation because, again, it embraced plurality very early on within the church. You still had some I don't want to mean plurality in beliefs, but plurality in practices. Because again, all of these churches had to embrace the Nicene Creed. And all of them do, but their practices do vary. And they have different styles, and the Eastern Church welcomed that style instead of forcing everybody to be Latin, to be one thing. So this is why the East never had a Reformation, and why there are so many localized forms of Orthodoxy. Bulgarian, Ukrainian, Russian. Here in Panama City, it's a Greek Orthodox church. This is what we have. The Greek Orthodox is probably the most dominant behind the Russian Orthodox Church. But despite, eventually there was, the Byzantine Empire did experience a resurgence of power and influence under the Macedonian dynasties. You can see here 800s to the 1000s. The Byzantine Empire still was on a slow decline due to the Islamic caliphates. Things weren't helped when in 204, the city of Constantinople was sacked, not by Muslims, but by Christians. Crusading Italians from Venice came and sacked the city of Constantinople, greatly weakening the empire. And eventually, in 1543, the Ottoman Turks captured the city of Constantinople, ending the Byzantine Empire, ending the Roman Empire forever, and renaming the city to what it is today, the great city of Istanbul in Turkey. However, after the conquest of Constantinople, the Turkish Sultan, Mehmed II, actually allowed and encouraged the Orthodox Church to continue, to remain active. So the Orthodox ecumenical body of bishops, of councils that were known as patriarchs or the Patriate, he actually encouraged it to continue to meet even after the fall of Constantinople, where there was no emperor, there was no money being given. Mehmed, instead of forcing the church to disband, he encouraged it to be there. And he also forced the Eastern Church to become a little more Catholic, in that Mehmed created a de facto pope in a way, and that the Patriarch of Constantinople or the Bishop of Constantinople would serve as a de facto pope over all the Orthodox Church. And so that's what happened today. The Russian Orthodox Church doesn't recognize that, so you kind of have two pope-like figures over the Orthodox Church, the Patriarch of Constantinople and the Patriarch of Moscow. But there's really, but they don't recognize them as pope, but they kind of behave like the Speaker of the House. They rule over the, they preside over the College of Bishops or College of Ministers that run the church. But however, you know, as we kind of, I've already kind of said here, after the fall of Constantinople, well, prior to it, the emperor was very conflicted with the Russian church because the church was starting to exert more power. The Russian Tsar started to see himself and the church as the third Rome. The name Tsar in Russian means Caesar. And so they, after the fall of Constantinople, the Russian church saw itself as the continuation of the Roman church. And so sometimes Russia referred to itself as the third Rome, and they still see themselves as the protectorate of Orthodox Christianity. So I did have a clip here from a speech given by Putin, but it's been removed from the internet, where Putin, Vladimir Putin, the president of Russia, gave those same sentiments of why Russian troops were in Syria fighting the Syrians and stuff like that. And he said that Russia is there to protect the Orthodox Christians. And so even today, Putin himself sees himself as being a protectorate of all Orthodox Christians. And so that's a little bit about the Orthodox Church during the Reformation.